Hey guys, it's Phil here from the Goose Hummock Shop. As you know, we've done the intro to tuna fishing seminar a couple of times, and you can see that on our YouTube channel. What we have generated though is a ton of questions, a load of people asking questions. So what I thought we'd do is we'd just basically do a Q&A session. Jake put it out onto the internet. You've asked a load of stuff, so I'm gonna try and answer some questions. Here we go. And then if they have any questions at the end of this, send them in, we'll do another one. Hey. Far away, Jake. First question.
First question. I want to know how to catch tuna.
Yeah, you and me both. How do you catch tuna? Well, that's a long, that's the whole seminar. To read the intro to the tuna fishing seminar. Tuna fishing, all I would say, amazing species to catch. Incredible little adrenaline rush, whether you're running and gunning for them on top, jigging for them, bait fishing. There's nothing quite like catching them just because of the sheer size, strength, and aggression those fish show. It's too broad a question to ask, to answer in one go. So I think hopefully as we go through some of the more specific questions here, we can actually draw that out.
Looking to get into tuna fishing from a smaller center console, what's a good spinning setup?
Okay, so spinning set, it depends what size you're after. If you're after the smaller fish, in my opinion, the Shimano Saragossa is a really good way to go from a reel perspective. Normally the 20K, the 20,000 series, because it's big enough and has the line capacity and has a good drag. They've just launched the 14,000, which I haven't even seen yet, but it has come out as of January 2021. It should be on the streets. A little bit smaller, a little bit lighter. Great for the smaller fish. If you're targeting big fish, in my opinion, you've got two reel choices. You've got the Stella 20,000 by Shimano, and you've got the Saltiga Dogfight 20K by Daiwa. Best two reels. Basically the durability, the power you need, the drag you need, the endurance you need from a reel to catch the big fish, those are your only two choices. From a rod, a lot of different options. At a budget level, we do our own, the Mighty Fish Rod. The Vanstall VS325 is a really great rod, glass rod, you know, like $280-$300. Really lovely rod, and they work all the way through. The Team Boot Goose Classic is an ultra light rod. I've caught fish to 600 pounds on it on the spin, and that's going to set you back 500. And they go all the way up into, you know, $600, $700, even to $1,000, depending on what you want to do, and they get very specialized. So really, I say you want to budget yourself at an entry level, $750 for rod line and reel, and be prepared anyway for $2,000 if you really get the drug. Hope that helps.
Tips for landing big tuna in a smaller boat without a door.
Okay, yeah, well, it's ironically, I run a 39-foot boat and I haven't got a door, so it goes to some pretty big boats as well. Ironically, the small boats tend to have a lower freeboard, so you're actually closer, your gunwale's closer to the water. One of our customers, a friend of mine, Jay, is a phenomenal tuna fisherman, him and his son, Corey. They run a 21 contender, and they run a block and tackle off of the T-top, and they just basically have a piece of carpet they put over the back of the boat, and you just wheel him in over the back. Now, the contender actually has a nice, like, 45 degree angle. If you get into twin engine boats, you lose a bit of room. If you're coming over the side of the boat, block and tackle is the best way. You just need to be really careful. If you're in a small boat, you know, five guys and a bloody great fish hanging on the side of your boat is going to make it very tippy. So be really careful about stability. I had a guy custom build me a gin pole, which we fit into a small rod holder and then it bolts into the T-top. That allows us to get a fish much, much higher. And we've got 800 pound fish over the side of the boat on it. So it is doable. Block and tackle is the best way. Just try and be as careful as you can bringing them over, because obviously if you're trying to keep the fish for yourself or you're selling the fish, you don't want to damage it. Anything under 200 pounds, two of you on a gaff should be able to get it over the boat on your side just with a gaff in the head. And always bring them over head first, because you get the weight of the fish over the gunwale first.
How big of a boat do you need?
Depends on the sea, you know. There's some areas you can fish in the Cape where, you know, I've seen like 19 footers out there. So you can fish on a small boat. Don't be intimidated by the size of your boat. There's a guy who's been phenomenally successful. He fishes out of a kayak for him and catches, you know, good sized fish. Now, you know, people think he's a maniac and he's very dangerous, but if you saw the level of safety equipment he had on his kayak, it was better than most small boats. So don't be intimidated by it, but if you shouldn't be on the water that day, you shouldn't be fishing. And you know that based on the size of your boat and the weather conditions. And also think about very carefully where you're going. If the bite is at the Regal Sword, that's a 35-mile run east of Chatham. Now, if you're in a small boat and the weather's looking to come in, you wouldn't go that far, so fish inshore. So it's a common sense based on the size of your boat and the ability for it to take an ocean on any good day.
With limited rod holders, what are you trolling?
The cool thing about trolling now, the game the last couple of years has changed. I'll be back in a sec. So, I'm back. So traditionally, we always ran out of the outriggers. Okay, so if you don't have outriggers, now what are you doing? You're kind of using out the side of your rod holders and maybe two, you can maybe get three lines out. In recent years, they've started doing these, difficult to see on the camera. Jake might be able to give you a cut in after, but we have what's called tracker bars now. The great thing about these, you can run a rod in a rod holder and the bar is gonna swing out using the vane here to go much wider. And with that in mind, you're probably looking, you could get five rods fishing on your boat without even needing outriggers, which is cool. But also bear in mind, there's no point in fishing five rods if you're on your own, because you're gonna lose a lot of gear, which is good for business, but it's not good for you because you're gonna start cutting your lines off, you're gonna lose fish. Yeah, when I've got the full team on board, you know, sometimes we're running up to 11 lines, but sometimes if there's only, you know, two or three of us on the boat, we'll come all the way down to five. So depends on the day really, and depends on the size of your boat. But the tracker bars really allow small boats with no outriggers to compete with a wider spread.
Are squid bars then the best way to get started into tuna fishing?
Okay, so squid bars and tuna fishing, the lovely thing about squid bars is they tend to catch the smaller fish, okay? That said, you know, I had an 87-inch fish this summer, and that was actually my biggest fish. I was on a friend Ralph's boat. It's the biggest fish I ever caught on a bar. But I know if you speak to Taylor Sears and Mass Bay Guides, they've caught a lot of commercial fish this year on bars, so it's certainly doable. And the nice thing about bars and catching smaller recreational fish is most of you guys out there are gonna have a recreational license, so you don't want to tangle with a monster, because it's gonna take you hours to try and catch it. You're then gonna be have the, you know, the death or glory conversation about disposing of the fish. You're gonna have to spend a lot of time swimming it, getting it back in the water, yada, yada, yada. And it's not good for you or the fish to target them if you're not keeping them, unless you're really proficient in the release techniques. So the bars are gonna catch smaller ones. We had a period of time, about 2-3 week window east of Chatham this year, when the bars outfished everybody and everything. You could hear people on the radio asking their mates, because they were bait fishing, can I borrow some bars off you? People were catching 6, 8, 10 tuna a day in the 35 to 50 inch category. So what I would say when you're trolling, you know, don't be afraid of bringing your gear down a size. You know, I fish 30s and 50s sometimes when I'm on the bar bite, and I'll use 80s in the long corners. But you know, catching smaller fish is a great way to start. And there's nothing quite like watching a tuna hit a squid bar. It's absolutely explosive. It's really cool, gets the blood pumping.
Does the area you fish depend on the time of year, specifically the bank and east of Chatham?
Okay, tuna are classified by the government as a highly migratory species. So they move a lot. You know, we posted it on our Facebook page a couple of days ago. One of my previous staff members, Captain Eric Stewart, caught a fish in 2012 east of Chatham at the Regal Sword, and it was 45 inches, I think, and it is just being caught a few weeks ago off the coast of Spain. So they're incredibly migratory. They tend to come, you know, they're down in the Carolinas right now, and they follow the bait. You know, when the bait comes up, they tend to follow it. So the smaller fish this year, they stayed off New Jersey, Rhode Island, because that's where the sand eels were. And the bigger fish, they were here big time, because we had a ton of mackerel and a ton of pogies. I would suggest that east of Chatham and Stalewagen on any given day is a great place to fish. But you find the baits. Look for the birds, find the bait, then they're probably going to be tuna there.
That brings us to, you touched on it, but how do they migrate in general?
It's a water temperature thing, and it's also a bait thing. You know, bluefin tuna never stop swimming. They swim like 15, 20 miles an hour all day. So they burn a huge amount of calories. And as such, they need to eat a lot, and that's why they chase the better food sources like mackerel and pogies, because of the oil in them. And that's why, ironically, when we talk about migrating, Jake, is that's why there's a big swoop into the bay in the summer, because they come and chase the bluefish, because they're big and they're fatty, they've got a lot of calories in them. So what we tend to find is that the fish will come up, they tend to come up from the south and they run the canyon line, and then they tend to cut in at somewhere like Veitch or Hydro, normally to south of the islands, so catch a couple early, sometimes early June, south of the islands, and then they move their way up north, they come through Chatham and up to Stellwagen, up to further north onto Jeffreys, and then they get the big fish go all the way up to Nova Scotia chasing the bait. And the big fish tend to come first because the big fish tend to be able to handle the colder water because they're cold-blooded. And that's why in the fall, as you get now in December, is, you know, big fish are getting caught, but less small fish are getting caught because the smaller fish tend to migrate first. But it tends to be a north-south migration. The research is ongoing and it's incredibly informational now, you know, about the fish actually. We thought it was a completely different body of fish in the Mediterranean, and as Eric Stewart, as I said earlier, he's proven it's not. It's actually some of the same fish actually making that transatlantic move, and again, it depends on the bait.
Why is it so important to take time to swim the fish back?
Okay. So the way I look at it is, you know, I'm 54 years old, a little bit broad around the beam. I could go and run 2 miles any day. Right now, I could go and jog 2 miles. If I went and sprinted 800 yards, my life depended on it, there's a chance I'd die. Literally. I'm not going to try. It's because the amount of lactic acid I'll burn up and the amount of oxygen I'm going to burn is going to deprive me. Now think, a tuna is fighting for its life. It fights really, really hard. And ironically, the quicker you bring them to the boat, the more active lactic acid they build up. And what you've got to do is they can't just release it. That's why if any of you guys out there were an athlete, you talk about warming down after you've played. I was a lacrosse player. We always used to warm down. So what you've got to do is you've got to allow that fish to warm down. And the best way of doing that is to swim them gently. And basically you tow them behind the boat. The old way of doing it was you put a gaff through them, which I do not recommend, because you leave the fish with a hole in its mouth and you potentially damage its blood veins and it potentially reads out. What we use, Exhibit A coming in, this is an Italian invention. It's called the Pratico Big Game Grip. You quite literally, it's like a giant boga grip, and you literally open it. You put it in its lower jaw, so it's here. You tie a dock line to the end, you cleat it off, and you'll see video on our website. If you follow Dave Marciano, Dave uses one of these very successfully on Hard Merch and on Falcon. I think Dave Carrera's using it, I think TJ's using it now. Very popular for swimming the fish. Even if we're killing the fish to sell to the market with a commercial license, it's still really important that we actually let that fish cool down, get rid of what's called the burn, and get all the lactic acid out of it. And don't be thinking it's a 5 minute job. You know, if you have a 500-600 pound fish, you can be swimming it for 40 minutes, okay? But to be fair, you're towing it at 2-3 knots, head for home, pull the fish home, and eventually on your way back in, that's when you stop, bring the fish into the boat, gut it, clean it, pack it with ice, etc., if you're selling it, okay?
How do I get into run and gun fishing?
Okay, best way to get into run and gun is to book a captain, quite sincerely. You will learn an awful lot by going out on a boat with one of the run gun and specialists. You know, people we know up here, there's the Matt Pratcherers and Tighten Up Charters, and you've got Bobby Rice runs Real Deal. They're great captains, they've got really good boats, they specialise in the run and gun for tuna. There's a number of other guys looking for those fast centre consoles. I would definitely rent one first. It's fine, it's going to cost you $1,200, but the amount you learn on that charter is going to be worth it. And when you start to do it yourself, I don't know if this is going to come up in other questions, but getting into it, you're not looking for the fish, you're looking for the birds. You really want to be looking for shearwaters especially. And the art is to work out where the tuna are going to be, not where they are. And you need to find out, you need to figure out where they're going to be in 30 seconds so you can settle your boat in front of them. And when you see people like Matt or Bobby fish, you won't see them charging down on top of a shoal of fish. They'll be moving up to it, and they'll be moving in front of it to catch the fish as they move into it. It's going to allow you to have a much better casting shot at feeding fish. It's going to spook the fish a lot less, and you're probably going to get multiple casts into them in the feed. Really important you do that.
How to find fish on top?
Okay, sometimes you'll see them crashing because they are, especially when they're on the half beaks and they're chasing them out the water, you'll see fish a mile off. What you're really going to see first is shearwaters. And if you see a load of shearwaters just generally bucking it from A to B, they're not actually on top of tuna. If you see shearwaters following along, looking down, changing direction especially, and in a pack following, they're following tuna. Okay, so just keep following those birds and eventually those fish are going to break. But those are really what you're looking for.
How to retrieve a Ronzee when casting on the bus stops?
Okay, so Ronzee. So Ronnie, bless him, who's no longer with us, was an incredible guy actually, and a great tuna fisherman. Developed the Ronzee soft plastic, which at a soft plastic level is still the best, in my opinion, soft plastics to cast at tuna. He's done the hook now, obviously he's got an angled hook so it doesn't pivot as much, and they go anything up to about 5 ounces now as a head. And what you're going to do is, basically it's the same when I'm throwing the other hard lures, is you're casting it, you're basically letting it sink, and then it's a jerk and a sweeping action, and then stop. And invariably when it stops and it just dives head first again, that's when you'll go tight, okay? And that's what I would do. And remember, when you're casting a Ronzee or any other lure, you're casting 5 yards in front of the fish, not at the fish, because by the time your lure lands, the fish is gone. So you want to be up front in front of the fish. Okay? And the other thing I say, ironically, we had a couple of years ago, we were having great fun. We were moving around trying to find the fish, so we were edging around at 2-3 knots. And I just chucked this over the side of the boat, and we trolled it probably 60-70 yards behind the boat. And then every time we marked fish, we just put it in neutral, and just the sheer action of this fluttering down into the fish, we were going tight mid-water on small fish. We probably had about 6-7 schoolie class bluefin that day. It was really good fun.
What is the best butterfish imitation?
Butterfish is a pain in the ass because they're really small and they swim slow and they swim near the surface. It's a perennial challenge. What do you throw? Do you try and make it get a cast master and throw a cast master at it? Because you can make them small, sparkly. Problem with that is they sink really quickly, so you have to retrieve them fast. So very naturally, you've got to match what the bait are doing. What we're finding more recently, for example, this is the new, I haven't got the other one upstairs. This is the new Proteus by Strategic Angler, which I think is absolutely killer, because this is the kind of size you want, but it's got a bit of weight to it, so you'll actually be able to throw it. This is a new lure, albeit it's a sardine pattern. This is IMS, this is a wooden lure, custom painted in Eastern Europe. So you're looking at these little baby lures. Butterfish are a pain. I was with my friend Ryan from My Fishing Cave quite a couple of years ago. We cast absolutely everything at them. And eventually, ironically, I had a mackerel, physical mackerel, about this big in the live well. This very sad little thing it was. And I put that on a 6-aught bass hook with 60-pound fluorocarbon on a bass rod, and we pitched it over the side. And I pretty much say 20 seconds in, we were tight on a 47-inch fish. So you've got to get really small. But the good thing is that our manufacturers are working really, really hard to find these small butterfish patterns. I think 2021, we're going to have a range of lures that are going to be brilliant for them.
What is your favorite tuna bait or lure?
Ooh. Two very different things. From a bait perspective, I am a big mackerel fan because there's loads of them. Again, you don't really fish mackerel when they're all fishing on pogies and vice versa. You know, we had some great times this year. I mean, P-Town Harbour, we had tuna coming and bushing up on schools of pogies. That's when you want to fish a live pogie. Sometimes when the wind's blowing a bit, fishing a bluefish off a kite bait, you know, big chunky bait, is brilliant. So the baits I really use is I'll use mackerel, pogey, bluefish, herring sometimes, if you can get them. Herrings are a little bit challenging to get sometimes because as soon as it gets really light, they don't tend to bite, so they're hard to catch. But those three baits are definitely my favourite. Stellwagen actually herring works quite well. And on the artificials, yeah, I'm a big fan. Yeah, I'm really good friends with Merv, I suppose. So this is a strategic angler sinking a spada in the half big pattern in sort of like late September, October into November. They're really on the half beaks. It's a phenomenal fun chasing them. This is a phenomenal lure for it. Yeah, those are expensive. At a more budget level, you've got the Dorado slider. This is for $35. You just pull it, it walks the dog beautifully. And then what we're finding now is these jig baits, you know, coming in. This is the new bigger Proteus by Strategic. I love some of the Siren lures. We've started selling Siren in the shop now. So I don't have a favorite, to be fair, Jake, but I suppose if I had to go one hard, one soft, Ron's in and a spada would be where my money's at.
What to throw when you're not sure what they're eating?
Don't throw it. You should know what they're eating.
Quick and easy.
That's quick and easy. You should realize what they're on, guys. You really want to, if you're chucking a sand eel pattern into a load of mackerel that they're feeding or vice versa, you're probably not going to get a bite. Especially if you're jigging as well. But yeah, you should have a really good feel for what they're feeding on. And then try and match the hatch as much as possible.
Terminal tackle for giants in the bay.
Okay. The water dictates your terminal tackle. If it's gin clear, you want to come down in your size. Bear in mind, if you are fishing in the bay, you're probably not going to catch a 45 inch fish. You're going to catch a big one. So say if you have a recreational license and you haven't really caught a lot of big fish before, don't fish in the bay, because the chances are you're going to hook into a really big one. There's a lot of lobster gear to navigate around, which kind of makes you want to fish heavier. We tend to be fishing these, we're fishing the 130s more. But if it's really calm and the water's clear, you probably want to be fishing 150 pound test. If you're in the bay and it's a snarly, snotty day and the water's all dark, fish 200 pounds because they can't see it. So kind of the water clarity and disturbance in the water is going to dictate what line you actually use.
Hook size, leader lengths, how far are your weights, crimp and swivel size?
Sheesh. Okay, where should we start? We'll start moving down the line. So swivel, I tend to run the Spro. I either run the 330 or the 230 pound class. The leader, yeah, the crimp, obviously. The crimp is, I use Jinkai as a crimper. I use the Jinkai crimper. They're the best crimps and crimpers in the game. Totally depends on what size. I don't mind. They do a short crimp, they do a longer crimp. I prefer the longer one because I can crimp it three times. Just means you've got a better connection. I haven't really found the fish care that much. And the leader, you know, I either use Seagull Blue Label or Seagull Premier. Those are the two colours, and I use anything from 150 to 230, 220, sorry, depending on it. Hook size for live baiting, I'm a big Charlie Brown quick rig fan. I tend to use the 9-0 to the 10-0. They're ringed, which allows the bait to move more. And obviously we rig them with rigging bands, or there's some new technology coming we might have in the shop called a Catalina rig. But you basically don't. I'm not a big fan of hooking the bait straight onto the hook. I like to use rigging bands. And again, if you're using a mackerel this big, don't use like a 7-0 hook. But flip side of that, you know, last December, December 1st actually, 2019, we had a 570 pound fish. We couldn't get mackerel bigger than this. They're little tinks. So I use a 7-0, you know, 7-0 Charlie Brown. Got it right in the corner of jaws. And like I say, it's 570 pound fish. So your hook size, you know, again, if you use like a 9-0 hook on a kite bait, you know, I'll just show you something, Jake. Kite bait, difference in size. You know, if they're consuming a whopping great bluefish, they'll take a big hook.
Wind-ons versus FG knot.
Big fan of wind-on leaders. Basil Pappas, BHP wind-ons, love it. I fish Cortland C16 hollow core, I love it. It's really soft. It's a really good quality hollow core. I use it from 60 pound through 200. I use it on pretty much everything now. I love the fact that we can back splice a loop into it, so I haven't got a knot. and then I use a BHP wind on leader. FG knot will work fine. You know, you can, there's no reason why you can't also do a loop to loop and just either do a surgeon knot or your abinomi twist. Just takes a bit longer. I love these, really easy, guys, really easy. And again, you've got no knots in there, or it's all spliced in, so you've not got a big FG knot or something coming through your guides. So casting and things are going to be easier.
You kind of touched on it, but what is the difference between hollow core and braid?
Hollow core is hollow, and what it does is allows you to splice much easier. And a spliced line is going to have a much lower profile and no knots. So it's just going to go through your guides in and out. And when you're tuna fishing, you've got huge pressure on your line as you're bringing your line into your rod. Having nothing, no nicks and dinks stopping it, I just think is a good thing, which is why I use the hollow core and the wind-ons. Diameter-wise, braid is actually slightly thinner, so you can get a few more yards on. But, you know, on one of these big bad boys, a 200-pound hollow core, I'm still getting 700 yards on, so I get plenty of C16 on.
What is the best way to rig a ballyhoo?
Different seminar. Haven't got the stuff here. We tend to pin rig them. We use the big tuna krakens. We skirt them onto a pin rig, or you can rig them with wire and an egg sinker. Sometimes we'll run them naked, so we won't skirt them. But we'll do another seminar, Jake, and we'll actually show how to rig them.
Still on the ballyhoo, do you need ballyhoo on all trolling lures?
No. No, you can run deep divers. I use the Nomads, the Yozuris, you've got the big C30s, they work well, big diving lures. Normally when we're in the spread, especially at the canyons, I have two of those off the back of the boat. Ballyhoo, we tend to have ballyhoo in the spread, and that's because on our boat we run what's called a triple halyard. So we have the ability to run three things at a time off each outrigger, and I'll run bar, ballyhoo, bar. And I'll do that both sides, so we normally have two ballyhoo in the water, and we'll run one short, one long. And sometimes if we're in a mood, we'll run one right down the middle in what's called the shotgun.
Do you think stretching out your 65 to 80 pound fluoro before jigging is worth it?
Yes. Stretching your fluoro out anytime is worth it because it has memory. And if you just think, if you're in the water and you're jigging, when you go slack, that line is going to try and coil up. So anything you can do just to quickly pre-stretch it, I wouldn't say do it obviously every drop, but especially if your line's been on the spool for a while, just stretch it out, and all I do is I put it on a cleat, I go up the line, and I just wrap it around my wrist and pull it. That's all you need to do, just give it a little bit of memory. Take the memory out, sorry.
How should you react when a tuna takes your balloon down, hits the bait?
Normally you go pretty fucking crazy, but we try not to go too mad. The two things you gotta do, firstly you gotta let it run, especially as we're using circle hooks. The bait's going to get swallowed by the fish, and then as it comes up, it's going to get it in the jaw. So if you're using J hooks, you can really slam the anchors down. We tend to go for a softer bite and let the fish run a bit. The key things you've got to do in my world, as I run a big center console, is firstly you've got to get all the other gear in. So I have somebody on the rod keeping an eye on it, because if the fish turns, you've got to be ready to reel. But if it's running, let it run. You've got 900 yards of line on one of these bad boys. It ain't going anywhere. And then the next thing we do is we try to get the rod up to the bow of the boat. And we like to fight off the bow of the boat, because it gives us much more direction. And then actually, you know, I run a 39-foot contender. I've had a big fish tow us 8 miles plus at 2 miles an hour. So, you know, let that wear the fish out. Wear it a lot quicker out than you will.
How to not pull the hook?
Don't be a thug. Pulling the hook isn't, you know, it happens. It's sometimes a byproduct of you being too hard on the fish. Sometimes it's a byproduct of simply your hook didn't get good enough bite in it. Especially if it's gut hooked or something like that, the hook might slip. We rerun the drags pretty heavy, but the hook gets pulled an awful lot right at the start of the fight and right at the end of the fight. At the start of the fight, it's kind of like shit happens. If it's at the end of the fight, you know, if you think you're on the bow of a boat, you're going up and down in the surf, suddenly you're trying to pull that fish a lot further quickly with a much shorter line, which means your mono's not stretching at all. So with that in mind, what we tend to do is the fish is getting closer to the boat, we're backing off the drag a bit. so the drag will give. That's the best way. That's about it. I think that's all the questions. Thanks very much for listening. We're going to be doing a ton of other seminars. So what I say you do is if you could please like and subscribe onto our YouTube channel. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook. And yeah, feel free to message us and say if there's anything else you'd like us to do. I think we're going to do a specialist one on trolling, and we're going to do a specialist seminar on rigging ballyhoo. I'll get Danny to do that. He's great at it. But like I say, if there's anything else you want us to do, if there's any other content, you know, this winter COVID is going to keep us locked down. It's a great way of us spending some time. We really love doing it, and hopefully you really enjoy listening to it. Thanks very much. Stay safe.